السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. My name is Dr. Ahmed Ria Abdul Wahab. I am a clinical and interventional radiologist working currently in Erbil, Iraq. Today I want to talk to you about venous Doppler ultrasound. What else to see? When I started writing this seminar at the beginning, I was planning to talk only about the non-vascular causes of lymph edema and or swelling. However, I discovered that it will be so inadequate and deficient to talk about the non-vascular causes and leaving the vascular causes. So I rewrote this seminar to cover both the vascular and the non-vascular causes. So, at the beginning, when a patient comes with a lower limb swelling and or pain, we start by doing an ultrasound exam of the lower limb, usually a Doppler exam of the lower limb. And there are numerous findings encountered during venous examinations. We should try to indicate the cause of pain or swelling from both the vascular and the non-vascular causes because recognition is important to institute appropriate treatment. First, let's start by vascular pathologies. The most famous vascular pathology of lower limb swelling and or pain is by far the DVT. So let's talk about the DVT or deep venous thrombosis. The problem is that clinical diagnosis of DVT is at best only 50% accurate, while ultrasound is 95% sensitive and specific at above at knee level and above. So, what about below knee level? Below knee level is a relatively insignificant risk because it's very rare that we have a serious complication of a below knee venous thrombosis. However, the ultrasound sensitivity and specificity remains relatively high. Some basic facts about deep venous thrombosis. There are approximately 20 million cases of DVT per year in the USA and approximately 20,000 deaths per year from pulmonary thromboembolic disease in the UK. There are many ways to many findings or signs of to diagnose deep venous thrombosis. In my opinion, by far the most important one is compressibility. In this figure, we can see when we start first examining the femoral artery and vein, we will see this appearance, the artery and the vein. But when we start applying compression, normally what we should have is total and complete obliteration of the vein. So in fact, this drawing is not entirely accurate. In reality, we should never see the vein when we compress it if it was normal. If I saw this appearance on a real patient, I would go with a chronic DVT or partially recanalized DVT. The vein should completely, totally disappear. While in acute condition, the vein does not disappear or does not even shows any signs of compressibility. So compressibility is by far the most important signs of to diagnose the deep venous thrombosis. And by the way, it does not even need any Doppler examination. So we can diagnose it without we can diagnose a loss of compressibility without even using the Doppler exam. For example, in this case, you can see the vein has an echogenic heterogeneous internal echoes, and with application of the compression, as we can see, the vein here is the artery is a little bit narrowed with atherosclerotic calcific fossae seen on the wall of the artery, while the vein is not showing any signs of compressibility. Also here, we can see that the vein contains an echogenic material and it is not compressible, diagnostic of a venous thrombosis. So these are the diagnostic criteria of deep venous thrombosis. The normal veins or the patent veins should show spontaneous flow with augmentation on flow, and it shows response to probe compression with a phasic Doppler waveform and without any intraluminal echoes. And the color Doppler imaging should fill the lumen completely, while the thrombosed vein there is no spontaneous flow, no augmentation, and there is absent or diminished probe compressibility, but absent Doppler waveform, while there is a usual intraluminal echoes and the color filling is absent or incomplete. For example, these are the signs that we talked about. I will show you in details. For example, in this case, you can see this is the artery and this is the vein. There is a spontaneous flow in the vein and the color is completely filling the lumen of the vein. This is a normal vein with no evidence of a venous thrombosis. Again, the same thing here, you can see it, and in the axial views, you can see the artery and the vein, and the color is homogeneously filling the whole lumen of the vein. And there is also the variation of the spectral waveform, the normal phasicity of the venous blood flow. You can see here there is a changing flow pattern of the venous blood flow. Again, here you can see the augmentation. When you compress on the cuff, there will be sudden increase in the velocity of blood flow in the vein. This is a normal vein with normal augmentation. However, if you are suspecting a DVT, or if you saw a DVT during the examination and there is loss of compressibility, try not to do an augmentation, because with augmentation you might dislodge an embolism resulting in a pulmonary embolism, and you might cause the complication for the patient. So try to avoid doing augmentation. And you can do augmentation either by compressing on the cuff or just by asking the patient to take a deeper breath. It will do the same idea, especially at above any level. And one thing I want to tell you about is the phasicity that we see in the normal veins. If it is lost, if there was a flow, but it is a monotonic flow, there is no changing in the velocity of the flow. Think of a more proximal obstruction, for example, like a pelvic mass. So what we see here is an example of a non-occlusive thrombus. You can see the thrombus here filling most of the lumen, but not all of it, and there is some flow still remains here. Also, the same thing in the axial cuts. You can see this is the artery, and all of this is the vein, and this is the thrombus filling most of the lumen of the vein. So now we have to differentiate between acute DVT and a chronic DVT, and we have to differentiate between a completely recanalized and a partially recanalized chronic DVT. The signs for acute DVT, as we discussed, there is intraluminal echoes, and it's usually hypoechoic in the acute stage with a venous distension and collateral vessels. There is no spontaneous flow and no augmentation, and there is no response to probe compression. While in complete recanalization, it's almost normal venous appearance. However, there is only might be a slightly reduced response to compressibility, and you usually see evidence of a vein wall thickening. So what we see in a chronic completely recanalized DVT, in fact, is a narrow caliber vein. Otherwise, it's normal. You see the vein and you think this is a small vein. I usually see the vein larger than this one. So think of a chronic completely recanalized DVT. If it is partially recanalized DVT, you will see is there is a markedly reduced response to probe compression. You compress the vein, is compressible but not totally compressible. Okay, this indicates a partially recanalized DVT. Another cause of lower limb or upper limb swelling and or edema is venous congestion. Usually presents as bilateral leg swelling. What you should know is that DVT in bilateral leg swelling with no risk factors is less than 5%, while if there is a risk factor, it's about 23%. So what are the risk factors that we are talking about? There is a score called Wells Clinical Score that describes these risk factors, which are, for example, active cancer, paralysis, bedridden more than 3 days, localized tenderness, and swelling of the entire leg, calf swelling more than 3 centimeters compared to asymptomatic leg, pitting edema, collateral superficial veins, which are non-varicose, previously documented DVT, and alternative diagnosis as likely or greater than that of DVT. DVT is unlikely if you collect a score of less than 2, while it is possible if the score is 2 or more. So keep this in mind and then decide whether DVT is likely or unlikely. Now, let's talk about a really common cause of lower limb pain and swelling, which is varicose veins. Varicose veins, in fact, they are just a dilated, tortuous, superficially located venous channels. The risk factors for developing varicose veins include pregnancy, age, female sex predilection, prolonged standing. It's either due to incompetence of the saphenofemoral valve or due to incompetent perforators, or maybe both of them. There is a lot of discussion on how to diagnose varicose veins and what to report and where to detect. However, I found that the easiest thing is to look for valve incompetency. Valve incompetency includes both the saphenofemoral and the saphenopopliteal valves. Try to examine the patient in a standing position and look for the site of the saphenofemoral or the saphenopopliteal valve and do an augmentation. When you do an augmentation, what will happen is the following. The blood, press on the calf, the blood will go in towards the heart in both the deep and the superficial vein. This is a normal response. Now, remove the augmentation. When you remove the augmentation, the competent valves in the deep veins will prevent the blood from flowing in a backward direction, that is, towards the feet. However, if the saphenofemoral or saphenopopliteal valve is incompetent, it will allow blood to flow backward, that's toward the foot. Measure the duration or the time that the reflux takes. If it is more than 1 second, then this needs surgical intervention. If it is 0.5 to 1 second, this needs conservative management. If it is less than 0.5 second, then usually it's insignificant. This is a diagram showing the sites where to look for the perforators distributions and to where to look for the saphenofemoral and the saphenopopliteal valves. This is a very nice example showing the small saphenous vein joining the popliteal vein here. And when you do an augmentation, the blood will go in both the deep and superficial veins towards the heart. This is normal. Now, when you remove the augmentation, the competent valves of the popliteal vein will prevent the blood from going back into the popliteal vein, while the incompetent saphenopopliteal valve will allow blood to go back towards the feet. So what you will see here is blood is going toward the heart with compression, while blood is going toward the foot in the absence of compression. All what you need to do is to measure the time this phenomena takes here by pulse wave Doppler. You can see here this is the normal appearance. The blood goes towards the heart, and when you remove compression, it reflects for less than 0.5 seconds. This is normal or insignificant. While here, there is incompetent valve resulting in blood reflux for a long duration, more than 1 second, and obviously this needs surgical intervention. Now, let's talk about the non-venous vascular pathologies. The most important and the most complicated one is arterial atherosclerotic disease. Arterial atherosclerotic disease is a really long subject, so I will not talk about it in details. However, I want to show this example of a thrombus here filling the lumen of the artery and resulting in a narrowing of the artery and elevated blood velocity. As we can see here, it's almost about 150 centimeters per second. This obviously needs some sort of intervention, whether by stenting or by medical treatment or whatever. This will need a full explanation in a whole other seminar. So now I will bypass this particular subject. Other non-venous vascular pathologies include pseudoaneurysms. Pseudoaneurysm, in fact, is just a breach in the vessel wall. There is a hole in the wall of the artery. It results in a blood leaking into the adjacent or surrounding soft tissues, and the blood is contained in the adventitial layer of the surrounding soft tissues. So the main difference between pseudoaneurysm and the true aneurysm is the lack of wall. Pseudoaneurysm does not have a wall, while true aneurysm have a wall. So this means that there is a high risk of rupture of a pseudoaneurysm compared to a true aneurysm, because there is no wall to support it. What are the causes of pseudoaneurysm formation? Number one is trauma. Any aneurysm resulting from trauma is a pseudoaneurysm. Okay, by far the most common cause of pseudoaneurysm is iatrogenic trauma. That is, usually it's formed after femoral artery puncture during catheterization, usually cardiac catheterization. When we remove the catheter and we compress the site of the puncture, the compression is inadequate, and when we remove the compression, the hole in the artery will stay patent and result in pseudoaneurysm into the adjacent surrounding structures. So the good news here is that if the pseudoaneurysm is a fresh, that is less than 1 week duration, most of the times it's possible to treat it using a non-invasive ultrasound examination, and I will tell you how in a while. So this is the pseudoaneurysm. You can see here what we see is a typical this is a sign called yin-yang sign. Yin-yang sign, of course, everyone have seen it in the Chinese or Japanese movies. This symbol, symbolizes the balance between good and bad, day and night, and things like that. The same appearance we see in a pseudoaneurysm, blood going in and blood going out of the aneurysm. It has no discernible wall, and when you remove the color Doppler, you can see there is a partial thrombus formed within the lumen of the aneurysm. How can we treat this? If it is fresh, it should be fresh, that is less than a week of age, just try to locate the neck or the site of the blood leak from the arterial wall, and using both hands and all of your strength, compress at this point. Compress very hard for about 10 to 15 minutes, which is a really long duration. If you are doing the compression, it will make you so tired. So preferably two sonographers should be available and exchanging roles. Everyone, each one compresses for a few minutes. After 10 to 15 minutes of compression, remove your probe, and usually you will have a thrombus formation within the lumen of the pseudoaneurysm, which is enough to occlude the hole in the wall of the artery, and it will be a very nice treatment without need for further intervention. However, if this fails, or if the pseudoaneurysm is more than 1 week of age, then some sort of surgical management is indicated. Another vascular pathology for lower limb pain and swelling is an arteriovenous fistula. Again, arteriovenous fistula is just a connection between the artery and the vein, direct connection. Okay, mostly the vast majority is caused by iatrogenic intervention during catheterization. Sometimes we create an arteriovenous fistula, for example, during hemodialysis to treat renal failure. We need arteriovenous fistula. So what we will see here is we will see one of two findings. Either direct communication between the artery and the vein, or if we fail to see the site of communication, we will see evidence of arterialization of the vein. We see a vein that has all the criteria of an artery. As in this example here, you can see the artery and the veins. The veins has the same pulsation of the artery with the same velocity and the same direction. This is arterialization of the vein that we see in arteriovenous fistula. The non-vascular pathologies can be divided into common and less common pathologies. And by the way, these are not rare, these are just less common. The common pathologies include edema, hematoma, lymph nodes, and popliteals or Baker cyst, while the less common pathologies include abscesses, joint effusion, adenopathy, and tumors. So, let's talk about soft tissue edema. Soft tissue edema, it's a common cause of lymph swelling and pain, and usually it is due to elevated venous pressure or elevated hydrostatic pressure. The common causes of increased hydrostatic pressure include congestive heart failure, fluid overload, deep venous thrombosis, venous compression, and venous obstruction. What will happen is that fluid will be seen in between the subcutaneous soft tissues, giving them a reticulated or a marbled or a cobblestoned appearance. That's what we will see in a soft tissue edema. One of the common causes of soft tissue edema is congestive heart failure. What we will see, the sign that will help us to differentiate the congestive heart failure as a cause of the edema is increased pulsatility in the venous waveform. When you put a pulse wave Doppler on the vein, you will see there is an increased transmission of the cardiac cycle into the vein. The vein is pulsating just like an artery, however, it's a vein. Okay. Usually it's a bidirectional pulsatility, also can be seen in tricuspid regurgitation. It might mimic arterial pulsation, so be careful that to be sure that this is a vein before you suggest congestive heart failure as a cause of this finding. Now, these are all different forms of congestive heart failure resulting in increased pulsatility of the vein. It can be something like that. Or like that, it can be like this, can be like this. It will differ according to the heart rate, according to the blood pressure, according to the state of the valves of the veins, and many other factors. However, it is a congestive heart failure causing increased pulsatility of the vein. So, again, regarding edema. Edema is just a fluid collecting in a subcutaneous fat, resulting in a marbled or reticulated appearance. The soft tissue swelling caused by the edema might result in attenuation of the sound wave. So you might want to shift to a lower frequency probe, like using curvilinear probe to detect the soft tissue edema and swelling, the depth of the edema. Lymphedema, it is exactly like edema from a sonographic point of view. We cannot differentiate the cause of lymphedema. We cannot differentiate lymphedema from edema using ultrasound findings, or in fact radiologic findings, all of them. So it can be uni or bilateral, and it is usually as the result of lymphatic obstruction, which might be seen in malignancy, trauma, and surgery. The only differentiating factor to differentiate this is lymphedema or edema is we might sometimes see enlarged lymph nodes in patients with lymphedema. This enlargement of the lymph nodes might be suggestive of lymphedema as a cause of the lymph swelling. Lymphedema is quite common in female patients after mastectomy. because during mastectomy they do a whole complete axillary clearance. They remove the lymph nodes, causing lymphatic obstruction, resulting in upper limb swelling caused by lymphedema. Also, it gives us a fluid collecting between the soft tissues with reticulated or cobblestoned appearance, and this resulting in attenuation of the sound waves, and we need a lower frequency probe to see the whole depth of this soft tissue swelling. Another cause of lymph swelling and edema is hematoma formation. Hematoma can be focal or diffuse. And usually we should look for history of trauma, exercise, surgery or anticoagulation. It might be cystic complex or solid in appearance, with presenting with a smooth or irregular borders. The very differentiating finding about hematoma is that it tends to retract over time. That is, with time it gets smaller and smaller in size. It may spread in the facial muscle planes, might present as a hypoechoic or isoechoic collection. Very important finding is that there should be no flow in the mass on Doppler exam, no flow within the mass. Keep this in mind. Maybe around it, yes, but not inside it. If it is large enough, it might result in compression of the adjacent vein. So assess for venous compression. And the lower velocity, if it is compressing the adjacent vein, it will result in decreased blood flow velocity of the adjacent vein. And this low velocity might be difficult to detect. So be careful not to say this is an occluded vein, while it's just a compressed vein, not occluded. So it's not a DVT, it's just a venous compression caused by the hematoma. You should be careful not to miss that. This is a panoramic view showing the hematoma within the gastrocnemius muscle. It is iso to hypoechoic in appearance, and you can see the hematoma here taking a relatively complex cystic appearance with internal septi and some partial soft tissue appearance. Another kind of hematoma containing internal septations, and you can see the hematoma here is present with an entirely hypoechoic pattern, just like a simple cyst, but this was in fact a hematoma. Muscle injury is another cause of pain and swelling in the lower limb. It can result from blunt or penetrating a trauma or due to muscle pull during vigorous exercise. Usually it's associated with hematoma and inflammation at the site of the tear, and initially it's hyperechoic and intragenous, and with time, usually after 7 to 10 days, it tends to change to intermediate or low echogenicity. This is muscle tear within the gastrocnemius muscle. You can see the hematoma formation and the swelling and edema of the muscle fibers and the increased vascularity, indicating inflammatory changes. Again, after a while, it tends to change to a hypoechoic level, and it becomes more clearly well defined, this muscle laceration. So, other causes of lower limb edema and swelling are lymph nodes. Lymph nodes, usually we look for them in the groin, in the cervical, and in the axillary regions. Or they might be prevascular around the aorta, IBC, and iliac vessels. The features that differentiate normal from abnormal lymph nodes, the normal lymph nodes are usually show a hypoechoic peripheral mantle and a hyperechoic central fatty hilum. Okay, the hilum contains the vessels that feed the lymph nodes, the arteries and the veins. Usually they are oval shaped, almond shaped, with less than 1 centimeter in shortest dimension. You can see this is a normal lymph node. Also, this is a normal lymph node in the axial plane. Lymphadenopathy is enlargement of the lymph nodes. They become mass-like lesions. They can cause a swelling with venous or lymphatic obstruction and result in pain and inflammation. Color Doppler show in a benign lymph node usually shows an arterial pattern that passes from the hilum and branches into the periphery of the lymph node in a tree-like appearance. And the, when you put a pulse Doppler shows a low resistance pattern. Low resistance pattern, that is what we mean by low resistance pattern is the end diastolic velocity is far away from the baseline. It does not reach the zero level. If it reaches the zero level, or at least it's very close to the baseline, this indicates a high resistance pattern. What we see in inflammatory lymph nodes is usually a low resistance pattern. Again, this is another example, a lymph node with a benign looking appearance. This blood vessels are arising from the hilum with a low resistance pattern of blood flow. Different kinds of lymph nodes, you can see here and here and here. This is a fatty hilum, slightly reduced. By Doppler exam, it shows a benign appearance. Now, how to differentiate inflammatory from malignant lymph nodes? To be honest, I don't think there is any radiologic examination that can differentiate inflammatory from malignant lymph nodes. Well, that's apart from the PET exam. I'm talking about CT, MRI, and ultrasound and X-ray. Inflammatory lymph nodes usually they have some features that might be suggestive of a benign inflammatory changes rather than malignant infiltration, but all of these signs are not sensitive and not specific enough. Inflammatory lymph nodes usually maintain their ovoid elongated shape, with the short axis is less than half of the length of the node, and the central hilum is intact. Its fatty hilum is spared and preserved. So this oval shape and the maintenance of the central hilum usually more suggestive of an inflammatory or benign lymph node rather than malignant. While malignant lymph nodes are usually more rounded in appearance and they lose their echogenic central hilum, and the vascularity is heterogeneous, arising everywhere or from the periphery, from the center, from everywhere. This is more in favor of a malignant lymph node. However, usually we use the size, the shortest diameter of the lymph node to indicate the shortest diameter of the lymph node, we use it to indicate lymphadenopathy. Never measure the longest diameter or the longest dimension of a lymph node. It is considered in radiological literature. What we consider is only the shortest dimension or the shortest diameter. All of the signs that we mentioned to differentiate between malignant and benign lymph nodes, all of them are not sensitive and not specific. However, unfortunately, we don't have any other way to differentiate. I will tell you a story about a patient I have. He was a known case of a thyroid carcinoma, underwent thyroidectomy, and then after that treatment, he presented to me for a routine follow-up exam, and I found by ultrasound only few bilateral small lymph nodes, that is about 3 or 4 millimeter in shortest dimension. So I suggested that they are mostly reactionary in nature. However, his physician insisted on doing an FNA for these small lymph nodes, which were really difficult because they were very small lymph nodes, like 3 or 4 millimeters. However, I went and I aspirated and did the FNA, and unfortunately they were full of malignant cells. So this is a lesson: never to judge a lymph node benign or malignant by using radiologic criteria. If you don't have a histological or histopathological or cytological criteria, or at least a PET scan, then just suggest that these lymph nodes look benign or might be malignant, but don't give a full confirmation because you might miss big time. Again, this is an example of a malignant lymph node surrounded. There is no fatty hilum with a markedly heterogeneous peripheral vascularity. Again, this appearance you usually see in lymphoma. Now, let's talk about another cause of lower limb pain and swelling, that is popliteal cyst. Popliteal cyst is a focal fluid collection found behind the knee posteriorly and medially to the knee joint. It's a fluid collecting in the gastrocnemius semimembranosus bursa, usually due to inflammation. Inflammation results from arthritis like rheumatoid arthritis, degenerative joint disease, trauma, infection, dialysis, and hemophilia. And it usually, it might extend to the calf muscles and it might rupture, resulting in pain and tenderness, might mimic DVT. Popliteal or Baker cyst is a common finding during venous duplex examination. It's usually seen on the adjacent to the medial head of the gastrocnemius, and always you should try to look for the connection with the joint capsule. It's usually easy to see its connection with the joint capsule. It has a smooth margin with a well-defined walls and no internal echoes, and as any cyst, it has a posterior acoustic enhancement. You can see here this area most likely will be the connection with the joint capsule. If it ruptured, then it will show an irregular wall of the cyst with some echogenic internal debris, and so you can see some fluid in the popliteal fossa and extending down into the calf, and it has no internal vascularity. The differential diagnosis includes hematoma, abscess, tumor, and edema. These are examples of popliteal cyst. You can see here there are some internal debris suggesting possible rupture or infection or even bleeding. You can see this is a Baker cyst, well defined, and it's connected with the joint capsule here. The same thing here. Another cause of lower limb pain and swelling includes joint effusion. Joint effusion, it's a distension of the joint capsule with fluid. It can be due to inflammatory, infectious, or traumatic causes. It can be simple or complex on ultrasound. If it is indicated, just put a needle there, aspirate some fluid, and send for analysis. You can see here this is the bone cortex, and this is the joint capsule, which is distended by fluid of the joint effusion. This is a nice demonstration of the joint effusion. You can see here, this is a normal appearance. The capsule is concave with respect to bone, while here the capsule is convex with respect to the bone cortex. This is a joint effusion of the hip joint. This is the hip joint. And you can see the joint capsule is distended with the fluid. What is interesting here is that you can see the growth plate here is still present and prominent, suggesting that this is a child. So a child with joint effusion, you might want to think of septic arthritis as a cause of joint effusion, especially if it's clinically indicated, if it has signs of infection. So if it was me, I would consult the orthopedist the orthopedician regarding putting a needle there, aspirating some fluid to detect whether it's possible or not, because septic arthritis is an emergency and need fast and urgent treatment. Soft tissue infection can be a cause of lower limb pain and swelling. They can be difficult to identify, usually present as skin thickening, edema, swelling, and erythema. We call it cellulitis, which is a diffuse soft tissue inflammation of the skin and the subcutaneous tissues. The most common differential diagnosis is DVT, so you should be careful and try to exclude DVT as a cause. As any infection, it is associated with inflammation, which is associated with edema, giving this the edema appearance, the reticulated pattern, and with time it will mature up into some sort of phlegmon formation, then it will form an abscess. The abscess is a well-defined collection in the soft tissue, which can be a simple or complex in appearance, may contain gas bubbles, which are seen as bright reflectors with posterior acoustic shadowing. The abscess is associated with a relatively thick wall, and might contain some internal septation, and it has peripherally increased vascularity, and usually is associated with increased echogenicity of the surrounding fat. This increased echogenicity is suggestive of abscess formation. You can see here different examples of abscesses. For example, this abscess here associated with increased echogenicity of the surrounding fat, it appears as a complex lesion. Also this abscess here and here associated with increased echogenicity of the surrounding fat, and it has some thick wall, and it appears relatively multi like lobulated appearance and ill-defined, not very well defined. Again, different kinds of abscesses. You can see that this abscess is extending into the deeper soft tissues. Other cause of lower limb pain and swelling is tumors. Tumors, they can be benign and malignant. Solid masses in the tissues should be distinguished from superficial or deep venous thrombosis. Be careful to distinguish between them because they are of entirely different etiologies. The benign tumors, there are many benign tumors that can be seen in the limbs, including lipomas, hemangiomas, fibromas, desmoid tumors, neurofibromas, leiomyomas, and by far the most common are lipomas. Lipomas usually present as iso or hyperechoic lesions with scant or no internal vascularity. Because they might be isoechoic, they might be difficult to detect in the subcutaneous tissues, so they may require CT or MRI for the diagnosis. Lipoma here, you can see it here and here as an isoechoic lesion, especially here. It's very difficult to see, and that's common, unfortunately, during practice. We see the mass, we feel the mass. When we put the probe, there is no mass. It's not that there is no mass, but the mass is just so isoechoic it cannot be seen. And that's why we might need CT or MRI to diagnose it. However, fortunately, lipomas are very benign tumors that usually requires no intervention at all. Other kinds of benign lesions include hemangiomas and neurofibromas here. Malignant tumors, they can be primary or metastatic disease. The primary tumors include sarcomas and lymphomas, while metastatic disease include they can be from anywhere, especially lymphoma, leukemia, and melanoma. Metastases can present as simple or complex masses. Usually they have a high velocity, high peak systolic velocity, more than 25 cm per second, with a low resistance arterial flow pattern. This is low resistance flow pattern. The end diastolic is not reaching the baseline, and you can see here it's above 40, it's above 25 per second. This was a sarcoma here, you can see, with a heterogeneous vascularity. This was a metastasis. Also, you can see hypoechoic mass, ill-defined, irregular, increased peripheral vascularity. If we put the pulse wave Doppler here, we will see a low resistance pattern. So, in conclusion, the cause of extremity pain and or swelling can be vascular or non-vascular in origin. The non-vascular findings are common during venous duplex examination. We should keep that in mind, and the recognition is critical for the diagnosis. And the integration of the history with sonographic and the clinical findings is very essential for the diagnosis. Thank you very much.